The children of 9th standard. Now in this video, we are going to start a poem from your Beehive textbook. The name of the poem is A Legend of the Northland, written by Ferb Carey. Now, from the title itself, we can see that this poem is about a Northland area. This means that the area which is near to the North Pole. Now, this poem, The Legend of Northland, is a ballad. Now, what is the meaning of ballad? So, a ballad is a poem narrating a story in short stanzas. Ballads are a part of folk culture, a tradition, historical continuity of popular culture, and are passed on orally from one generation to the next. So, we can say ballad is a traditional stories. Legend means historic story. So, now this poem, A Legend of the Northland, saying a story. Now, this poem has 16 stanzas and each stanza is having 4 lines. Now, the poem is a legend about an old lady. Means the poem is a historic story about an old lady who angered Saint Peter. Now, who is Saint Peter? So, Saint Peter is a great saint of Christians. Now, why she angered Saint Peter? Because of her greed, because of her selfishness. So, let us begin the poem. But very first, I'll give you short introduction about the poetess Ferb Carey. Now, Ferb Carey was an American poetess. She took birth on 4th September 1824. She was the younger sister of poetess Alice Carey. The sisters co-published poems and after their deaths joined anthologies of sisters' unpublished poems were also compiled. Now, what is the meaning of anthologies? So, anthologies means a collection of selected literary passages. Ferb Carey died on 31st July 1871. Now, let us begin the poem. I'll read the stanza and stanza-wise I'll explain you. So, first stanza says that, away, away in the north land, where the hours of the day are few and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. So, in this stanza, poetess says that in the region around the North Pole, Northland, the duration of the day is very less because its position is such that the sun's rays reach for a very less time. When this area is experiencing winter season, the duration of the night is very long and when this area is experiencing winter season, the duration of the night is very long and the daytime hours are very less. In line 4, they refers who lives in this region. So, the poet says that the duration of the night time is so long that the people cannot sleep them through. If they go to bed, take a few hours of sleep and then they wake up, it is still night time. So, she wants to emphasize on the fact that the duration of the night is very long. In second stanza, poetess further says that where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows. And the children looked like bears' cubs in their funny furry clothes. So the Northland region experiences severe cold conditions and it is a snowy area. Now the reindeer is an animal which is found in this polar region. People tie the reindeers to sledges. Sledges means cart vehicle. And then the reindeers pull the sledges. Further, she adds that the children look like young ones of a bear because they wear funny looking clothes made of fur, which is like the furry skin of bear. Further, in third stanza, poetess says that they tell them a curious story. I don't believe this true. And yet you may learn a lesson if I tell the tale to you. So, in this stanza, poetess says that the elders of the Northland region tell a strange and interesting story to the younger generation. The poetess says that she does not think that the story is true, but if she tells the story to the reader, maybe the reader could learn a lesson from it. The story gives an important message. Now, my dear children, after this stanza, the story starts. Now, what is the story? Poetess wants to tell through this poem, and what message we will get, that we'll see. So further, poetess says that once when the good Saint Peter lives in the world below and walked about it preaching just as he did, you know. Saint Peter is a great saint of Christians. They walk around the world and give religious lecture. Preaching means religious talks. So, in this stanza, poetess says that the story is about Saint Peter. When Saint Peter used to live in the world and went around giving religious lectures to the people, just like all saints do, then an incident happened. Now, what incident happened? So, he came to the door of a cottage in traveling round the earth, where a little woman was making cakes and baking them on the hearth. So, when Saint Peter was moving around the world giving religious lectures to the people, he reached the door of a cottage where a small woman was making cakes. She was baking the cakes on the fireplace. Further, what happened? So, further, poetess says that, and being faint with fasting, for the day was almost done, he asked her from her store of cakes to give him a single one. So, as Saint Peter had not eaten anything the entire day, he was very hungry and was feeling weak. So, he went to this woman who was baking cakes and he asked for one cake out of the many cakes that she had baked. Further, poetess says that so she made a very little cake, but as it baking lay, she looked at it, and though it seemed too large to give away. So now in this stanza, poetess says that the woman was selfish. She did not give cake from her store. Instead, she started making a very small cake for Saint Peter. She did not want to share her things, but when she put the cake for baking, she looked at it and thought that this cake was too big to be given to someone. Further, the story goes on, and in 8th stanza, the poetess says that therefore she needed another and still a smaller one, but it looked when she turned it over as large as the first had done. Now, see what she did. The little miser woman thought that the cake was too big to be given away. So, she started making another smaller cake. When she looked at the cake, she again felt that it was a big as the previous one. Again, she was not ready to give this smaller cake to Saint Peter. Now, in 9th stanza, poetess says that, now, therefore, then she took a tiny scrap of dough and rolled it flat and baked it thin as a wafer. But she could not part with that. Now this time the miser woman took the tiny scrap of dough, means small amount of dough, or we can say very small quantity of dough. She started rolling and she rolled and rolled as thin as wafer. Now you all can imagine how thin she baked the cake, as thin like wafer. But this time also, she was not ready to part, means not ready to give this thin piece of cake to Saint Peter. Now, my dear children, you all can imagine this lady was so miser. Further, poetess says that, for she said, my cakes that seem too small when I eat of them myself are yet too large to give away. So she put them on the shelf. Now, the woman gave the justification. She said that whenever she ate the cake, she felt like the cakes were too small. But when it came to give someone, she felt like it was too large, too big to be given away. So without giving any cake to Saint Peter, she put all the cakes on the kitchen shelf. Further, poetess says that then good Saint Peter grew angry, for he was hungry and faint. And surely such a woman was enough to provoke a saint. So after watching all this, Saint Peter grew angry because he was very hungry and also feeling weak. This greedy and selfish woman could not give a small piece of cake to Saint Peter. Her behavior was enough to cause anger to Saint Peter. Further, poetess says that, and he said, you are too selfish to dwell in a human form, to have both food and shelter and fire to keep you warm. So now Saint Peter cursed the woman and said that you are very selfish and she did not deserve to live as a human life. See, my dear children, God has given us human life. Why? So that we can feel another person's sorrow, problems. And see this woman. This woman was so selfish. So further, Saint Peter said that as human life is a gift, a boon from God, God had given her everything, food, shelter, a fire to keep her warm. But in result, this selfish woman did not want to share a small piece of cake to anybody. So now further, poet says that now you shall build as the birds do and shall get your scanty food by boring and boring and boring all day in the hard dry wood. So now Saint Peter cursed the woman and said to this selfish woman that she would become a bird because she did not deserve a human life. She will become a bird, and just like birds do, it bore and bore on the wood, and after boring all day, it get very scanty, very little food. In the same way, she would also work hard in dry wood, and by boring and boring on a dry wood, she would get little food, and by working so hard, she would make her living. Further, in stanza 14, poetess says that then up she went through the chimney, never speaking a word, and out of the top flew a woodpecker, for she was changed to a bird. So as soon as Saint Peter cursed the woman, she did not get any chance to speak, and without speaking, that very moment she flew up high through the chimney, or we can say through the fireplace, and flew out in the form of woodpecker. Woodpecker is a bird. So she flew out in the form of bird. So Saint Peter cursed had converted the woman, or we can say selfish woman, into a bird. Further, in stanza 14, poetess says that she had a scarlet cap on her head, and that was left the same, but all the rest of her clothes were burnt black as a coal in the flame. So when the woman turned into a bird, at that time she was wearing a scarlet cap, means red color cap on her head. So that cap was there as it is on her head, but the woman's remaining clothes had burned in that chimney, in that flame, and turned black in color just like coal. Stanza 16 says that, and every country schoolboy has seen her in the wood, where she lives in the trees till this very day, boring and boring for food. So now people who live in the countryside and the school going children seen this type of bird in the wood. They see that she lives there in the trees and keeps on digging the wood with her beak to collect the food. So whenever children see this kind of bird, their elders tell them this story about a greedy and selfish woman, and how Saint Peter cursed the woman and she turned into woodpecker, into bird. So my dear children, this was the explanation of the poem The Legend of Northland. Now we'll see the poetic devices which has been used in this poem. So very first, rhyme scheme. Now if you see, so in all the paragraph, in all the stanzas, the same rhyme scheme has been used, means same musical effect is there, that is A, B, C, P. We'll see. Now see, first stanza, last line is Northland. So D sound is coming here. So we'll name it as A. Now second stanza, first stanza, second line, last word is few. So, few, you, sound is coming. So, we'll name it as B. Now, third line, last word is winter. R sound is coming. So, again, we'll name it as C. Now, fourth line, last word is through. So, now see, second line, few, and fourth line, through. Same rhyme scheme is there. Same musical effect is there. Ooh, ooh. So, again, we'll name it as B. So, with this, our rhyme scheme became A, B, A, B, C, D. We'll see. In second stanza also. Now, see, in second stanza, last word is reindeer. So, R sound is coming. So, we'll name it as A. Again, see, second line, second stanza, second line, snows. S sound is coming. So, we'll name it as B. Now, third line, last word is cubs. So, we'll name it as C. And fourth line, last word is clothes. Now, see, fourth line, last word, clothes, is rhyming with second line, last word, snows. So, we'll name it as B. So, our rhyme scheme became A, B, C, B. So, my dear children, when you will see in all the stanzas, the same rhyme scheme is there. That is A, B, C, A. Now, we'll see the figures of speech. So, the very first figure of speech is alliteration, which is used in this poem. Now, what is the meaning of alliteration? So, alliteration means a repetition of consonant words or sounds at the beginning of two or more words that are close to one another. Now, see stanza 1. Stanza 1, fourth line, that they cannot slip, that they cannot slip them through. Now see, that they, them. So, the sound is coming. Okay, the sound which is consonant is repeating in the start of words. So, we can say this is the instances of alliteration. In same way, see, stanza 2, first line, where they harness the swift reindeer. Again, see, they, again, see, the sound is coming. Okay, and where the sound is repeating in the start of words. So, this is the example of alliteration. Again, in third line, to the sledges when it snows. To sledges, snows. So, sound is coming. So, and where? From the start of the words. So, these all are the example of alliteration. Now, see in stanza 3. First line, in stanza 3, first line, they tell them a curious story. They tell them a curious story. Now, see, they, them. Okay? So, see, again, the sound is coming, which is what? Repeating and which is consonant. And from where it is coming? So, and the sound is repeating in the start of words. Again, see, stanza 3, line, third line. What third line says? That, and yet you may learn a lesson. Now, again, see, and yet you may learn a lesson. So, your sound is coming, and yet you. So this is the example of alliteration. Your sound is repeating again. La la. La sound is repeating. Learn a lesson. So this all are example of alliteration. Now in this way, many alliteration figure of speech has been used in the poem. So further, in all the stanzas, just read the stanza and find out that where alliteration has been used. Now second figure of speech which is used in this poem is repetition. Now what is the meaning of repetition? So a repetitive use of words or sentences. So now see stanza 1. Stanza 1, when poetess says that away, away in the north land. So away, away word is getting repeated. So this is the example of alliteration. In same way, you can see that in stanza 9, stanza 13, stanza 16, repetition has been used. Like in stanza 9, when poetess says that and rolled, so again in stanza 13, when poetess says that by boring and boring. And boring. So this all are example of alliteration. See, when poetess says that by boring and boring and boring. Again see in stanza 16, when poetess says that boring and boring for food. So see, this is the example of repetition. Now see the next figure of speech which has been used in this poem is simile. Now what is the meaning of simile? So simile means comparison between two things using like and as. So in stanza 2, when poetess says that children look like bears cubs. Children look like bears cubs. So in this line, children have been compared by bears cub, by bears children, and they have used like. So this is the example of simile figure of speech. Now see in ninth stanza, when poetess says that and baked it thin as a wafer. So see, poetess says that cake has been compared with a wafer using as. So this is the example of what? Simile. Now the next figure of speech which has been used in this poem is anaphora. Now what is the meaning of anaphora? So anaphora means when two or more than two lines are starting with same words, then it is known as anaphora. Now see in stanza 12, when poetess says that to dwell in a human form, to have both food and shelter. When poetess says that to dwell in a human form, to have both food and shelter. So, my dear children, you can see that both these lines are starting with two. Okay, to dwell in a human form, to have both food and shelter. So, this is the example of anaphora, means when two or more than two lines are starting with same word. So, here see, in line 2 and line 3 are starting with same words, that is 2. Now, the next figure of speech which has been used is enjambment. Now, what is the meaning of enjambment? So, enjambment means when two or more than two lines are running without punctuation, then it is known as enjambment, or we can say when lines are continuing without using punctuation. So, see in stanza 1. In stanza 1, see line 3. Line 3. And the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. So, see, third line is continuing to line 4 without punctuation. Means, see, in the last of third line, no punctuation mark has been used. So, this type of figure of speech is known as enjambment. Now, again, see in stanza 2. In stanza 2, line 1, where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows. Now see, line 1 is continuing to line 2 without any punctuation. Means see, in the last, no punctuation mark is there. In the last of line 1, second stanza, no punctuation mark is there. So, first line is continuing to second line. So, this is the example of enjambment. Now see, again in third stanza, see, line 1 is continuing to line 2 when poetess says that they tell them a curious story. I don't believe it's true. So, no punctuation mark is used. So, this is the example of enjambment. Again, see, line 3. And yet you may learn a lesson if I tell the tale to you. So, again, see, in third line, no punctuation mark is there. So, this is the example of anaphora. Again, see, in stanza 4. Stanza 4, see, line 1. Once, when good Saint Peter lived in the world below. So, see, line 1 is continuing to line 2. Line 1 is continuing to line 2 without any punctuation mark. So, this is the example of enjambment. In same way, many enjambment figure of speech has been used in another stanzas. So, find out. Now, we can say that the poetic devices, that is first rhyme scheme. So, in all the stanzas, same rhyme scheme is there, that is ABCB. And means same musical effect is coming on, that is ABCB. And figures of speech which has been used in this poem is alliteration, repetition, simile, anaphora, and enjambment. So, by reading this poem, what lesson, what message we get from the poem? So, the poem conveys the message that as human beings, we should have positive qualities like affection, love, sympathy, generosity, that is kindness, and a sense of sharing. The poet also wants to say that people with negative inhuman values like selfishness, greed, and cruelty are ultimately punished. So, this poem gives us a message, a moral that we should follow in our life. So, this was the summary of the poem, A Legend of the Northland. We saw the explanation of the poem and the poetic devices. Thank you.